retreat leader is the Very Reverend Tryphon, Abbot and Father Tryphon, is the co-founder and abbot of the All-Merciful Savior Monastery on Vashon Island in Washington. Abbot Tryphon is also the popular daily blogger and podcaster of the Morning Offering on Ancient Faith Radio, and the author of a daily devotional also entitled The Morning Offering, which we have a supply of in the narthex by our bookstore, which Father Tryphon, I understand, will gladly sign. We also will have great vespers at around 4 after our retreat, and I invite all who are able to join us, and we pray that God would certainly bless this day and bless my good friend, Father Tryphon, as he inspires us.
Well, I have to tell you, I have been really looking forward to this. A moment ago, I saw this mass exodus, and I thought, I haven't even spoken yet, and they're leaving. And then I looked closely and saw that it was children, so I'm so relieved. This parish, as many of you know, is famous. I have heard about this parish for a very long time, and you're known as the hipster church. And for those of you who are not familiar with me, I'm the silverback hipster. So I've been told by a young hipster who owns a really great coffee house near Pacific Lutheran University, where I am a regular lecturer. They offered me an office there, and because whenever I lecture, students want to get together with me afterwards for private talks. And I said, I don't need an office. I have the best office. It's a block and a half away. They make the best cappuccinos in the entire region. It's owned by a 40-year-old hipster with tattoos. I fit right in there. I don't have tattoos, but I told one of his young, newly hired baristas that I am one of the original hipsters. And the owner said, well, he's now the silverback hipster. So that's where that comes from. So I want to start by saying that the topic of the Incarnation is really one of my favorites. And a lot of it has to do with the Orthodox view, which is so different than the West, of what it means to be the Incarnation of God in the flesh. It's a pivotal part of who we are as a faith community because it involves us in a very real way. When I was first tonsured a monk, about 34 years ago, I would say, and the first time I was out in public in my cassock, I noticed that everybody was staring at me. And it was unnerving when you're invisible and you're just regular people out there and people don't look at you. That's one thing. But all of a sudden, it was sort of like being in a Santa Claus suit. I remember once someone told me that they walked the length of a mall to go to work and they were playing this particular role. And at the end, when the end of the day, they left their uniform in a room, in an office, near their little throne. And then they walked out. Well, the whole day, even when he took a lunch break, he was a Santa. And everybody was staring and smiling and waving. And then when he left, he was invisible. He said it was sort of like that old movie, The Invisible Man. It's jarring. So here I am, all of a sudden, everybody is staring at me. Well, what do you do? Well, as a young, inexperienced monastic, I started to play the role. What do people expect of a monk? Well, a little dour, very serious, prayerful, prayer, rope in hand, not interacting with your environment. All those images that people had. And it was not me. I felt very uncomfortable with it. And I finally talked to my spiritual father about it, and he said, if you're going to journey to the heart of God, you have to have your heart in your hand. You have to own your heart. And as long as you are letting other people dictate to you how you should be, how you should act, how you should carry yourself, even as a monk, you don't own your heart. They own it. Think about it. And I said, well, what are you telling me? He said, be yourself. No, not that. Are you sure you mean that? And he said, if God is going to redeem your heart, he has to own it because you've given it to him. You haven't given it to someone else. So the key to spiritual growth for a monk, and for all of us, in fact, is to be yourself. And this is really hard, a hard concept for many in the Orthodox Church. Because we tend to be a church filled with people who have the same image of what it means to be an Orthodox Christian. Some take it to the extreme. Well, it means that you are Greek. You are in a Greek parish. Many years ago, we had a man from New York. He worked in a hospital, and he was ordering an average of 5 prayer ropes a month. And one day, when he called to order yet more prayer ropes, I was the one that picked up the phone. And I said, Richard, I've got to ask, why are you buying so many prayer ropes? Do you keep losing them? No, I give them away. Oh, I said, what a wonderful thought. You're teaching people the Jesus prayer. Yes. What parish do you go to? And he named an Episcopal church. And I said, Richard, the Jesus prayer goes with the pulse of the Orthodox Church, which is the Divine Liturgy. Have you ever considered becoming Orthodox? No, I haven't. I said, why don't you? Well, maybe I will. So he called me on Friday of the following week, and he said, during the week, there was a Greek Orthodox priest that came into the hospital to see a patient. And I went up to him, and I said, are you Greek Orthodox? And the priest said, yes. And he says, well, I've been buying these prayer ropes from this monastery on Vashon Island near Seattle. And the abbot there told me that I should look into Orthodoxy. And I've never been to an Orthodox church. And the priest said, come to my church on Sunday. Come as my guest. So this man came. He walked in, and being a good Episcopalian, he sat in the front row. That was a no-no. It was a Greek church. Only Greeks can sit in the front row. And then you have to be a special Greek. So one of the men who was one of the ushers came up to him and tapped him on the shoulder, and he said, you can't sit here. Why? This is reserved. Reserved for whom? Special guests. I'm a guest of your priest. You can't sit here. Richard was an Italian. Greeks don't tell Italians what to do. Italians don't tell Greeks what to do. It's a genetic thing. So Richard just, I'm not leaving. 5 Greek men came up to him. 5 against 1. You have to leave. You cannot sit here. You have to sit in the back. I am a guest of your priest. You have to sit in the back. This is reserved. Reserved for whom? Special guests. I am your priest, special guest. No, you're not. So he refused to leave, and he attended the whole liturgy from that front pew. Good for him. Unfortunately, He was then treated with a special coffee hour in his honor. He went down into the parish hall. He got his donut and his coffee. And a whole bunch of Greek men came up to him and said, "Why are you here? Are you Greek?" And he says, "No, I'm an Italian-American. Why don't you go to the Catholic church down the street? This is for Greeks. You are not Greek. You have to go to the Catholic church. That's for you. You are Italian." He left, and he never went back, and he never ordered more prayer robes. I can tell you a worse story. And this I heard from Archbishop Mark, the OCA Archbishop of Eastern Pennsylvania. I was there a couple months ago, or a couple, maybe 3 weeks ago. Thriving parish. There's a woman who's been studying Orthodoxy, and in fact, she had been listening to my podcasts. So she decided to attend an Orthodox church for the first time. She walked into this parish. And this grieves me to share the rest of this, but I'm going to. She was a black woman. And a woman went up to her and said, "There's a church down the street for you." She said, "People like you who are into," and then she named the drug. I can't remember what the drug was. She said, "That's where you're supposed to go." This woman left in tears. When Archbishop Mark heard about it, he visited the parish. And he's a very quiet person with a very quiet demeanor, quiet voice. And he stood before the entire congregation, and he told that story, what had happened, and he said, "Whoever you are, as your bishop, I am charging you as a penance that for the rest of your life, you are to pray for the salvation of that woman." And no one can lift this penance but me. That is your burden for the rest of your life. There are so many ways that we betray Orthodoxy and our witness. There's a young man who's now a spiritual son of mine from Spokane. He is a tattoo artist. Do I see any tattoo artists in here? I've heard rumors. And Shane, when I first met him, was not Orthodox, but he was very interested in Orthodoxy. And I established a brotherhood. Connor, stand up. Connor is one of the members of this lay brotherhood. It's called the Salish Brotherhood of St. John the Wonder Worker. He's one of our knights. And there are now over maybe clear, probably near 25 members now. 18 to 22 is the or to 32 is the age group. Any of you are interested, talk to Connor afterwards. And it's designed as a way of giving support to other young men in a commitment that is a commitment for life. In other words, it's not a monastic vows, but it's a commitment to a lay brotherhood, which has, I know in Russia this is a very common historical gathering of men who want to have support for one another. And the first and only one that I know of that happened in this country prior to our establishing this one was established by none other than St. John the Wonder Worker of Shanghai and San Francisco. And what they would do is these men would gather together for at different times during the year for spiritual renewal and maybe even go on pilgrimages together. And they had St. John as their spiritual father of the brotherhood. And he was their mentor in this spiritual journey into the heart of God. And So you can see the beauty of something like this, especially in an age when so many young men don't have fathers. So here comes Shane. He's been invited. And we're having this gathering at the monastery with a regular tent city out there on the grounds of the monastery of these young men. The initial time, there were 14. And Shane had been invited because Shane is a very serious journeyer. And Shane, I don't remember the circumstances, but Shane had been invited. And I had been told that Shane was a tattoo artist. And Shane was the last person to arrive, and everybody is already in Trappist. I believe we were having a meal. And somebody said, there's a car pulling up, and I looked out, and somebody said, oh, that's Shane. So I went out into the plaza of the monastery to greet him. And looking at him, he had this look on his face of fear. It was like the look of someone who knows they're going to be rejected. That's how he looked. And I went out, I greeted him with a blessing and a hug, brought him into the Trappist, and I announced to everyone, this is Shane. And I held up his right arm. Oops. I held up the right arm, and I pulled down his shirt sleeve so they could see all the tattoos. And you could already see all the tattoos that he had around his neck and one up here. And I said, and look at his groovy tattoos. Wow, everybody said. And all of a sudden, this Shane has a smile on his face. Well, as I was getting to know him, he told me a story. He and his wife and their children, on their journey to Orthodoxy, decided that they were going to go from Spokane to, I think it was Walla Walla, to a parish. Unfortunately, it was a Church Abroad parish. The priest is wonderful there. But I'm giving this story as a lesson to all of you as well. This parish has a number of families that are Coptic. I think they have one family that's Ethiopian. So they're a family, they're a parish, really a cross-selection of wonderful people. So he walks in with his family. They went there because they wanted to venerate the icon, the mercy-streaming icon of Hawaii that had been brought there. And you can imagine the impact that this would have had on not only themselves on their journey to Orthodoxy, but their little ones. They walk in. His wife has also lots of tattoos. And Shane told me that immediately it was apparent people were pulling their children away from this family. Like somehow they were going to get infected and go home with tattoos or something. I came so close to having Shane do a tattoo here. I was going to have a Coptic cross, because in Egypt, Coptic Christians routinely will have a cross here as a child, so that if they're kidnapped, they will always know they were a Christian. And I had this image of sitting on a bus, stretching in front of a bunch of ISIS types. Just letting them know that I am in solidarity with the Coptic people. But Shane said that because of my heart problems, it probably wouldn't be a good idea to do something like that, so I don't have it. Shane's wife looked at her husband and said, I want to get out of here. And she also left in tears with their children in tow. I told that story on my podcast. I'm not sure, but I think I did. Hoping that someone in that parish would read it. I didn't name the town, because the priest is a good man and would not have put up with this. But I tell you these stories because this is part of our response to one of the, probably the singularly greatest event in human history, when God took on our flesh and dwelt among us, and as he says, walked, I will walk in your midst. So the incarnation isn't just about the Logos taking on our flesh, it's about the impact that it has on us as Christians. I read this, and I don't remember where I read this. If anybody knows, they can raise their hand and share. But I read this somewhere, and the church, and I think, if memory has it, it's the Metropolitan John of Thessaloniki. I think that might be him. It sounds like him. He says, the church is a true church only if it is a local event incarnating Christ and manifesting the kingdom in a particular place. I'm going to read that again, and I want you to really take these words in. The church, if it is true, is a true church. The church is a true church only if it is a local event incarnating Christ and manifesting the kingdom in a particular place. There's another quote that may be from him. I'm one of these that scribbles things when I'm driving. Actually, I don't now. And it's illegal, and I shouldn't do this as a police chaplain, but I take my and I hit the little button so that I can record, and then I'll record things that I want to remember. So sometimes things like this, I'm recording them, and then I go back and I don't remember where I might have heard it or where it came from. But anyway, so a church must incarnate people, not ideas or beliefs. Because we Orthodox are, rightly so, concerned about dogma, we sometimes forget that for the church to be true to herself, she must incarnate people, which is you. It's the person that walks into your church who's never been there before. It's the person of a different race or a different style. I was at our cathedral in San Francisco, and we were lined up, the bishop here, the iconostasis there, two lines of priests. And I looked in the back of the church, and there were three priests that came into the church and stood in the back that were from Malankar Church, the Church of Egypt, of India. Both the Ethiopians and the Indian church get to wear colors that I can't wear, because if I wore that bright orange that one of the priests had, let me tell you this, when you are an old Norwegian, and I'm 70, and you have a white beard and white hair, I'm sorry, you don't get any whiter than this. And in fact, I have seen people meet me on the street and immediately reach for their sunglasses. So I'm looking in the back, and I see these three men. One of them is wearing a bright pink rasa, and the other one is wearing a bright orange one. And I'm thinking, oh, I wish I could wear those colors. And my second thought is, I want to talk to these people. And I'm praying that they don't leave until the service is over with. And we have a long ways to go. And I know that Archbishop Kirill would not look favorably upon me if I left the line of priests and went back to greet them. So I did. And they left, and I didn't get the chance to speak to them. But everyone that we look at is either our brother or sister in Orthodoxy or potentially our brother or sister in Orthodoxy. Everyone. Just as when I was in prison ministry, I did prison ministry once a month at Twin Rivers Correctional and another place that we referred to as the Big House, which is where the lifers were in Monroe, Washington. I would go there once a month for a day as the Orthodox volunteer prison chaplain. And let me tell you, when you're in a room with a guy who's there because he killed his wife, or you're in a room with a guy who's a rapist or a child molester, it gives you a real different perspective on the world because they all look just like anybody else. They don't have flies flying around them and they don't have a scar. And I had to really concentrate on, if I was going to truly minister to these people, I had to concentrate on the fact that everyone that I meet is either Christ glorified or Christ crucified. And in the case of people who are unrepentant, Christ crucified. Nevertheless, Christ. We have a slight difference in our doctrine of the Trinity than the West does. And most people aren't aware of it because so much of Western theology has sort of slimed its way into Orthodoxy. I've never used that term before, but forgive me if you're a Westerner. And that is that God the Father freely wills his communion with the Son, whom he begets and brings forth the Spirit. Thus, the Father is person, freely willing this communion. In other words, the Father, as God, wills this communion with the Son and the Spirit. And this is ultimately the iconographic image for all of us and how we relate to each other. We are the only religion that has the teaching that God became incarnate. The only one. Hinduism has avatars, but that's not God incarnate. It's a sort of a deity visiting among you at this particular time in history, or of a particular age, but it's not God incarnate. We have that. The difference between ourselves and Islam is that our God is a God who is willingly condescended to take on our flesh and then doesn't demand that we submit to him, but rather invites us to commune with him in a loving relationship. These are two different gods. I don't buy the idea that we worship the same God as Islam. We don't. It's not politically correct to say that. Stone me afterwards if you want. But this is the truth. That we do not worship the same God. Our God does not demand that unbelievers be executed. Our God does not demand that we submit, even unwillingly, in prayer. That's why we don't have this rule, you will be here at such and such a time for the formal prayers. We don't have that. You are invited, but you're not ordered to in order to be a good Orthodox Christian. It's a relationship. It's sort of like a husband and a wife. If the husband says nothing to his wife on a given day, doesn't communicate with her, and then some evening she says, honey, I don't remember the last time you told me you loved me. And his response is, well, you know I love you. I never hear it. Well, I love you, isn't that enough? Why do I have to tell you? If we really love God, we're going to tell them. If we really love our spouse and our children, we're going to tell them. And sometimes men have difficulty with that. So part of that incarnational role that we have as Christ's to our families, and especially to our children as men, is to demonstrate our love. I have a priest friend in another jurisdiction who shared with me his sadness that his bishop didn't like him, and his bishop was cold to him and constantly criticizing him. And he said, "I would just give anything to have a relationship with my bishop." And then he had a 25th anniversary of his ordination into the priesthood, and his parish put on this big banquet, and people were standing up and saying wonderful things about their wonderful priest. And the bishop was there. And when I saw this priest earlier, I asked him, how is it going with your bishop? And he says, "I can't believe it. He's been joking with me. He's been kind to me. He's been telling me how much he appreciates my ministry. I can't believe what's happened." And then something beautiful happened that brought tears to a lot of us. The last person to speak to this priest at this banquet was this bishop. And he stood up and he stood by this priest and he said, he looked right at him and he took his hand and he put it on the side of his cheek and he said, "I want all of you to know how I honor your priest. He's a good priest and I love him." And then he took his other hand and he caressed his face. And he said, right straight into his face, "Father, I love you." And he kissed him. And this priest could hardly control his emotions. You could just see it on his face how he was so moved by that he had tears welling up. I'm very fortunate that I was raised with a father that demonstrated his love to me. And I see that, I've already seen that in a lot of the young fathers here today. And I've also seen the end result of that in my spiritual son, Connor, because of his precious father who's loved him. That's obvious, because Connor is a young man full of love, quick to want to give it out to others. That's the result of a father who loved him. My father loved me. My father was a golf pro. When in the summertime, I used to, my brother and I would play 36 holes of golf every day. My dad was hoping that we would follow in his shoes and become golf pros. I still have my swing. I haven't played golf in over 30 years, but my dad, the last time he visited the monastery, he took out a club from the back of his car and he handed it to me and he said, "All right, son, I want to see if you still have your swing." So I looked around to see who might be watching. I stood there. And I can't do it. You get the picture. I had the swing. It was like a bicycle. You never forget how to ride a bicycle. I didn't forget my swing. But what I really got from my father was that he loved me. And he was the incarnation of Christ to me. He loved me. He loved my brother. And my brother and I are both out of that mold. I remember one day my dad's nickname was Big Al. Everybody called him Big Al. And over the years, as I've grown in wisdom and stature. I have had some of my priest friends give me the nickname, the Big T. So on my desk in my fabulous over-the-top office, I have a Big T. It's called a marquee letter. So it has these little lights, and you can, and it has a battery. And so whenever I'm holding court in my office, I turn that on, facing people. And I remember the first time I looked in the mirror when I finally saw my dad in me, because I looked like my dad. He didn't have a beard, but I looked like my dad. And I said, oh my gosh, I'm my dad. And then I thought, well, that's not such a bad thing, because when I was a kid, I was embarrassed about my dad, because my dad was one of these people that, you know, walked into a room, everybody knew he was there. He slapped people on the back. He loved everybody. He would spend 10 minutes talking to the guy that had just pumped our gas. That was my dad. I wanted him to be a conservative businessman who wore suits and was quiet. I don't wear business suits and I'm not quiet. But I shared this because the brokenness of the young people that I see when I go to college campuses. I routinely lecture at Seattle Pacific University, which is Free Methodist, Pacific Lutheran University, Tacoma Community College, occasionally Evergreen State, and the University of Washington. And the one thing that I have discovered in all these years is that this generation that we have today are not choosing atheism. They're being driven to atheism by an inauthentic Christianity that is driving them there. A Christianity that is so mixed with politics and anger and judgment. And the young people today, the thing that I have probably most admire about them is this is one of the first generations, I think, in our history as a nation where we have young people who are not interested in judging other people. They take them where they are. So I'll give you another example of this. There's a young man who came to the monastery with his professor and a class from Pacific Lutheran University. And as a former professor, I like to ask young people, what is your major? So as they were coming out, we were milling around in the courtyard of the monastery. I asked this young man, what is your major? And he says, oh, I'm going to be a Lutheran minister. And I said, no, you're not. And he looked and he says, what do you mean? I said, you've just tasted orthodoxy. About a year and a half later, we had a young man who came for a three-day retreat. He had long hair and a beard. He had turned into a hipster. And Father Moses said to me, you know who that is, don't you? And I said, no. He says, that's the young man that you said, no, you're not. You've tasted orthodoxy. That was the guy that was going to be a Lutheran minister. So he had been baptized and was now a part of this particular Orthodox church in the area. And again, I'm not going to name the parish, but one day he's sitting there. He had become a parish council member. And he's sitting there being a young hipster with a good mind, not unlike myself, he had a MacBook Air. For all you poor PC people to contemplate. And it was open. And he was the secretary keeping the minutes for the parish council. Being a product of Pacific Lutheran University and the young type that I'm talking about that are really open to others, this young man had a couple of slogans for the... One of them was the pro-marijuana initiative that the state of Washington had. So there was a little sticker for that. And another one was the equal sticker, which equal rights for same-sex marriage. Those were both on this thing. I told him that the greatest sin he had committed was putting stickers on a MacBook Air. I said, TCON is just not done. But the parish council president saw those stickers and said in front of everybody, how can you do that? And he said, well, I think that marijuana initiative, it should be legalized. My own friend, Sheriff Pastor of Pierce County, and one of his chaplains, was the first person to tell me, I hope it passes because I don't want to use the meager funds we have in our department to prosecute people that have marijuana on their presence, you know, on their person. And he says, and it pains me to see young people that are charged with a felon, and for the rest of their life it's going to impact them because every time they apply for a job, were you ever a convicted felon? Yes, I was. Doesn't matter what it was, you are a convicted felon, you're not going to get the job. So Sheriff Pastor told me that. So this is one of the things, but the big one was this equal thing. And the priest said, as an Orthodox Christian, you cannot believe that. Well, this is a newbie in Orthodoxy. Well, I don't know about you, but when I was a newbie in Orthodoxy, there was a whole lot that needed to be changed. But that's what the church is. It's a hospital. Now, if you are an emergency room nurse and someone is arriving in the emergency room on a stretcher, sorry, but he's too bloody. You'll have to take him elsewhere. We don't take people like that. Or a cancer treatment center. You have cancer? Sorry, this isn't the place for you. There's a sign that I saw recently. Someone posted it on their Facebook page, and I actually was tempted to have a sign made for us to have at the entrance to our monastery's church. The sign said, "The rumor," something like this, "the rumor is true that the church is full of hypocrites," but that, no, it says, "some say the church is full of hypocrites, but that's not true. There's still room." So I don't know about you, but I'm glad about that. And so when this young man was confronted by his priest for believing this, what the priest should have done, in my opinion, is let the young man find his way. Because we don't change the church. The church changes us. So leave him alone. There are bigger things. Before that evening was out, he was removed from the parish council, excommunicated. And this guy wasn't wanting to get married to a boyfriend. This is a young man who was already known to be engaged to a young woman who was interested in Orthodoxy. Neither of them go to church now. Are we surprised? I finally got them to come out and talk to me. And there was no changing him. He was so hurt by what happened that he and his bride-to-be are not interested in Orthodoxy. Well, that's the same problem that the American Baptist Convention had when they discovered that 86% of their young people were leaving the Baptist church once they got out of high school and were no longer under orders from their parents to go to church. And they decided, well, what we got to find out what's going on here. And one of the key things was young people had friends at school who had come out as gay that they loved and respected. And then they're hearing their ministers rant and rave. A better way, an incarnational way, is to do what the saints do and did. It is said of saints that they don't see the sins of others. They only see them their own sins. As long as we are focused on what's wrong with me and what's deficient with me and how I am not shining forth the light of Christ in how I live and how I speak and how I act. As long as I'm focused on what is wrong with other people, I will never grow spiritually and others will not see in me something to emulate. Which gets down to this all-important thing for all of us. Oh, and by the way, the parish also took away his scholarship. So he, here as ending his junior year, he was all of a sudden faced with, oh my gosh, I've got my senior year coming up. And you can imagine the black eye orthodoxy received by the professors on that campus. I heard about this story from a professor. He didn't tell me. He wouldn't see me. That is not Orthodox Christianity. It's not what Jesus did to the woman at the well. It's not the reason. If that was the case, Jesus would have avoided the tax collectors and the sinners that he dined with. Anyway, I want to share all this with you because the one thing that I have noticed when I go to campuses, I'm going to tell you a story that happened at Evergreen State College. Evergreen State is known as the most liberal state college in the entire public university system in Washington State. It's a beautiful campus. It's set in about 360 acres of forest. And it, when you go there, it looks like a utopian city in the future. I've been going there since it was new, way back in the 60s. And we used to have conferences there. And I had been invited for the first time in probably 3 years by one of the professors to come to speak. So I jumped at the opportunity. When I arrived on the campus, I followed the directions, and the building that I was going to be speaking in was a large lecture hall, the tiered traditional lecture hall, and a podium down at the bottom. And I was the first person to arrive there, and I thought, this can't be right, because the last time I spoke there, it was in a classroom. And I thought, oh my gosh, if we's going to have a class meeting here, and there's maybe 20 people in the class, and it's a huge lecture hall, this is not going to work. And then a few students started coming in, and I sat down thinking, oh no, this isn't going to work. And then he comes in, this professor, and I said, why are we using this big lecture hall? And he says, oh, well, this isn't for my class. This is open to the general student population. We have posters up advertising you. And I thought, well, this is a switch. This is known as Seattle now statistically has the most self-proclaimed atheists in the United States. And Washington and Oregon are the most unchurched of all the states. And this is the most unchurched of all the campuses. why are they having me in a big lecture hall? I pondered that thought. It was like this battle we had with Starbucks, and we finally won after 5 months, and I demanded kindly that maybe I at least have an end to this problem with them with the over Christmas blend, with a handshake, a tour of their corporate offices, and a free latte. And when they condescended to have me, and as I'm walking down this corridor with glass walls with young people working there, and nobody looks up. And I knew they wanted to, but they were instructed, don't look at them. And I felt like I had just been beamed up on the Enterprise from a primitive planet. Everybody's not to look at me because he's primitive. We don't want him to feel like he's in a zoo, so they don't look. I think they didn't want their people to look at somebody that won a battle against Starbucks, the evil empire. But anyway, I digress. Where was I? Oh, yes, lecture. So all of a sudden, the room is filled with, to more than capacity, there were people standing. There were 60 seats in that lecture hall, and they were standing room only. And I noticed that this professor is now hanging out in the very top back area with two other professors. And then I knew why I had been invited. I saw him. They were kind of like conferring. And I knew that I was this sort of like the Enterprise, been beamed up. Let's see how advanced we are by comparing ourselves to this primitive here. Oh, great, I said to myself. They're going to use me to dismiss not only orthodoxy and monasticism, but Christianity, and maybe even religion. Well, this was a moment of prayer. My first words in my thoughts were, help! I don't want to look like a fool. And then I said, if I ever needed the Holy Spirit, it's now. And I was a little whining in my voice, I think. And then it came to me. So I scratched my notes. And I stood at the podium and I said, I usually have a question and answer period at the end of a lecture. It was a 90-minute lecture. But I said, I'm going to do something different today. I am going to open it up to questions now. And these three professors leaned back now we've got him. And wouldn't you know, the very first hand that was raised was a young man midway up, raised his hand, and I said, yes, sir. And he says, my question is, why should I care about anything you have to say? I'm an atheist. Huh. So then I had, about maybe a year earlier, I had watched a lecture online, or a debate online that took place at Portland State University, Portland, Oregon, and it was between the theist and an atheist. The theist was he had a PC. Need I say more? And he was a young man, and he had his laptop open, and the atheist didn't have a laptop. He just had a few notes. And the atheist was just tearing this young man apart. They were both about the same age, but the atheist was winning his debate. I was a high school and college debater, and this was pathetic. It was just pathetic. If I had been there, I would have rushed forward and pushed that PC out of the way, set my MacBook Air down, and taken over. So then I thought, you know, someday I'm going to be in a situation where I'm going to be confronted with this issue, and I want to be able to be, I want to win this debate. So I started Googling, and I found this incredible debate between three deists and three atheists that took place at Cambridge University in England. And of course, there was this big lecture hall, and there was a graduate student in the middle sitting, you know, at this very imposing chair, and he was the facilitator for the debate. And he said, on this side we have the three that are representing the deists' view, and on this side the atheists' view, and you will judge who's the winner by which door you go out of. If you go out that door, you are voting for the deists. If you go out that door, you're voting for the atheists. If you go out the middle door, you don't know. It's a toss-up. And it starts. I don't remember the names of, but only two of them, one atheist and one deist. The deist was none other than the now retired Archbishop Rowan Williams of Canterbury, who's greatly influenced by Orthodoxy. On this side, he reminded me in his style of the world wrestling champion. You know, the guys that are wearing weird masks and weird outfits and angry, like this. Can you think of who it might be? You know. Dawkins, who is one of the most angry atheists that the planet has ever seen. He makes Lenin look like a happy camper. And so at one point, Rowan Williams says this eloquent statement that is very orthodox. He said that in Christianity, we have a science where we come to truth and knowledge noetically, the nous. And so, as we discover these truths noetically, intuitively, we go deeper into these beliefs, these ideas that we have gleaned, and then we discover the reality of the truth, and it's proven to us. And he said, we are not a science in the physical sense. Well, Dawkins was all over him, tearing him apart just viciously. The turning point of the debate where the deists won happened when one of the atheists sided with Rowan Williams. I was so excited, I was standing up with my laptop. I'm holding my laptop. Yay! I have one of the small ones. And the changing moment was when one of the atheists, who is a quantum physicist, turned to Dawkins and said, "You," and I'm paraphrasing, it's been a long time since I've seen this, but he said something like, "You are coming across sort of like a ranting, angry tele-evangelist." Boy, ouch, huh? Is that what you said? Ouch? Somebody? Yeah. Oh. And then he said, "Surely you know that we quantum physicists discover most of the truths that we accept to be true and that we later can prove to be true, we discover them noetically or intuitively. And he said 90% of what quantum physics teaches to be true is not provable in the physical, by the physical sciences, like biology. So I said that. I shared that. And there was a hush went over this lecture hall. And the professors, for a moment, looked defeated. And then we got into the nitty-gritty of talking about the spiritual life and why it should mean something. And the one thing I remember when I was a college student, back in 1840, was that the professors that I listened to the most and loved the most were the ones that I knew cared about me and cared about my opinion and actually listened to me with respect. I didn't have to be right, but they listened to me. And this is what I feel that is often missing in the way we as Orthodox Christians and as priests fail our young people. We're all about standing up officially in our role. I told my friend Father Basil Rhodes in Saratoga, California, that if I could, I would have my rasa tie-dyed. Because think of what a connection I could have with a lot of young people if I walked in. With a tie-dye. This could be tie-dyed. I could even have little lights blinking along here with a peace sign in the middle. Think of the doors that would be opened. And Father Basil said, yeah, but think of the doors that would slam shut. So I'm not going to do that. But if we're going to reach our youth, we have to be authentic. That's what they need. You don't need to be a hipster to reach them. But you do need to be authentic. They need to know that you love them. They need to know that you are happy they are there. They need to know that you care. I read this beautiful story about the elder Sophroni, and I believe it was the Metropolitan Herotheos Vlachos' book on the elder Sophroni of Essex, who will soon be a saint. And there was this story about one of his monks' daughter came to visit the monastery, and his daughter was not a practicing Orthodox Christian, and she arrived with a foot-long purple mohawk and piercings everywhere, eyelids, ears, lips, nose, and tattoos. And she had a black leather jacket with spikes. And you know what the elder Sophroni saw in her? The beloved daughter of one of his monks. That's what he saw. And at that point, he embraced her and welcomed her. I was so moved by that a couple weeks later, and I really feel this was providential that I had read it when I did, I came out of our grocery store on the island. And just as I'm coming out, there's a young couple coming in. They had matching purple mohawks. They had matching leather jackets with spikes. And the young woman had added to this ensemble. I don't use that word very often. Thank you. Do you use that word often? Your kids do? Okay. She had a fur around the top. But most interestingly, she had a raccoon tail back here. And before I knew what I was saying, I said, "Wow, I love your threads." Very counterculture, not unlike my own. And we went like that. 2 hours later, Zania calls, one of our parishioners. "Father, my daughter just called." She says, "I think I just met your priest." "She wants to meet you." You know, these are those moments when we are truly walking with Jesus. And we trust him so much that we're not guarding our tongues. I was with one of our bishops, Bishop George, who came to visit us years ago. He's now in Australia. He and I went to the Pike Market together, Seattle, the famous Pike Market. And afterwards, we crossed over where there are these big totem poles, and there's a view of the harbor, and we walked over there. And it's a place a lot of people that live in Seattle don't go, because there's an awful lot of transients that hang out there. And sure enough, there were lots of transients. And when they saw us, some of them made a beeline to us, thinking they were going to get money. And quite a few of them are Native Americans from Alaska who have problems with alcohol. And I'm thinking about that, and I'm not going to say anything because I felt ashamed that I hadn't been walking over there lately. Well, I go to the market. And that I was thinking, I need to. So we're walking over there, and this man comes up, a Native American. He looked very Alaskan. And he said, "May I have your blessing?" He was Orthodox from Alaska. And Bishop George saw around his neck that he had a cross. And he says, "What a beautiful cross." And the man said, "It's from Jerusalem." And the man was inebriated. And the bishop said, "Let me use your cross to bless you." So the man took his cross and he handed it to Vladika George. And Vladika George kissed the cross, blessed him with the cross, had the man kiss the cross, and then he tenderly put it back around his neck. And the man is just like, ah. And as we were walking away, I said, "Do you know that you just received a blessing from a bishop?" "I did." "Yes, you did." This is the incarnation at work. This is it. It's not about pomp. It's not about doctrine. It's not about being right liturgically and theologically. It's about incarnation. It's about love. It's about mercy. It's about being an instrument of God's mercy. That's what it's about. And it takes work on our part to do that. How much time do I have before we have our break? Half hour. Okay, I can do this one. Father Basil Rhodes, who's a Scotsman, has a kilt. I'm Norwegian, I don't. Father Basil said, well, if you drink enough scotch, you'll become a Scotsman, and then you can get yourself a kilt. I'm working on it. So Father Basil and his wife, Joni, they're from Saratoga, California, St. Nicholas. And by the way, happy St. Nicholas Day. Father Basil and Joni and I, every year, we take 2 days, 2 nights, and we go to Victoria, British Columbia. We like it going to Victoria because it's out of cell phone range. So we really have a break. I'm too guilt-ridden with my lingering Lutheranism to be able to actually turn my cell phone off. I'm always on duty, I feel, so it's always on, except now I listen to your priest. So we go to Victoria by the Victoria Clipper from Seattle, and the last morning that we were going to be there, we had had high tea. We had done all the things that people do in Victoria. But the last day we were going to be there, Father Basil and I got up early, and we went to a place called Murchie's. Murchie's is a famous tea house / do you know that place? Do you go there? Isn't it wonderful? Okay. Well, Murchie's, when you go in, they have this gilded gold sign in the window that says Murchie's. It looks like it's right out of the King James Bible. It's beautiful. You go in, on the right side is the coffee, on the left side is the tea. I go in there and I become schizoid. I came back and we had high tea at the monastery for 2 weeks in a row. And so, but I'm a coffee person, see. So we go into Murchie's and we ordered cappuccinos scones, beautiful, wonderful scones that they make there. These were the ones we got were the lemon scones, which are my favorite. If anybody wants to ever treat me to a lemon scone, go at it. So we take our scones and our cup and saucer out with our cappuccinos, and we sit out front in a little sidewalk cafe. We just sat down when out of the side of my eye I could see someone stopped, and I just knew, just as we sat down, this is going to be a spare changer. And before I could look, Father Basil, who had a direct view of this fellow, said, are you hungry? And the man said, yes. And Father Basil said, what would you like to eat? And he said, I would like sausages and eggs. And Father Basil said, well, they don't serve that here, but let me give you $5 and you can find it. So Father Basil hands me the $5, and I turned and handed the man the $5. The moment that happened, and the man was probably about 26, the moment that that happened, another young man who looked about 28 to 30 rushed forward, having seen me hand him the money, wagging his finger at me in my face and saying, how can you give that junkie money? Don't you know he's just going to buy drugs with it? And I said, it's not my place to judge. And he looks at Father Basil and he shakes his head and he says, you men are men of God. Don't you have any intuitive abilities whatsoever? And Father Basil said, the man said he was hungry. That's enough for us. To which the guy went like this, cheers, and he walked off. In a huff. There was a woman about 35 sitting at another table, and she called out immediately and she said, well said. I needed to hear this. I'm a social worker and I've been having a very difficult time. and I've been close to quitting my job. And I said, let me tell you a true story. So the young woman came over and she knelt down next to me, and I told her that when I was a young, newly tantric monk, I was walking in San Francisco with the late Bishop Mark of the Patriarchal Church of Russia. He was an old friend, and I knew him before I became Orthodox. And we were walking along in the street, both of us in our robes. And about a half a block away, coming right in our direction, walking very slowly with his eyes cast down to the ground, was the most filthy homeless person I had ever seen. His hair was matted and filthy with dirt. His beard was matted and filled with dirt. His face was filthy with dirt. His hands were dirty. His clothes were ripped. He had shoes on his feet, but he had no soles. And with every step, you could see bare feet. Well, I had put myself through graduate school in Berkeley as a bartender bouncer in an Irish pub. And immediately, the bouncer came back, and I felt obligated to protect the bishop. So I took the bishop by the elbow, and I said, Ladika, let's cross here. It's the middle of the block. Why? I said, well, look what's coming. No, we will keep the course. So as we continued walking, and I'm looking, keeping a sharp eye on this guy, ready to grumble. So I'm kind of moving the bishop a little over this way. And the bishop stops, just as the guy is right here. He stops, crosses in front of me, takes this man's hand, puts a $20 bill in it, takes the man's other hand, puts it over it, goes like this, and he looks at the man and he says, I want you to buy something good to eat. And for the first time, we saw the man look up. What I saw astounded me. And as we walked away, I said, Ladika, did you see that man's eyes? Those were not the eyes of a derelict homeless man. Those eyes were filled with love and mercy and wisdom. They were the whitest whites and the bluest blue eyes I had ever seen. And the bishop said, that's because we were being tested. That was an angel unaware. To which the young woman started crying. And then she said, I've got to go. I'm going to be late for work. And she rushed off. And then a middle-aged couple sitting at this other table. Can you picture it? The man calls out and he said, that is the most incredible story I have ever heard. You made my wife cry. And then Father Basil said, back. And the young man who had confronted me was there. And just as I'm braced for another, he says, I've come back to apologize. I followed him and I saw him buy yogurt and fruit with the money you gave him. Forgive me. To which I leapt to my feet, gave him a big bear hug. Sorry. Gave him a big bear hug. And I said, you were forgiven the moment the words came out of your mouth. And then we ate our scone. And drank our now lukewarm coffee. And when we were leaving, Father Basil said, you've got to write about that for your blog. And I said, well, you were here with me. I can. Because if you were not with me, I couldn't have written about it because people would have thought, oh, that's just fiction. So we went back to the hotel. I got my MacBook Air. Told him to leave his PC in his room. And we sat down in the coffee shop, and together we recounted every detail as I wrote this so that we wouldn't forget. And then we took the photo that Father Basil had taken of the front window of Murchie's. It's called Angel Unaware if you want to Google it. And there's this picture of the Murchie's window in that story. That is the incarnation. And I have to tell you, many years ago, I met a young man at the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley who was a seminarian. He was a Coptic Christian from Cairo. And he told me the story of this apparition of the Holy Virgin at St. Mary's Coptic Church. You Coptic people know this one. It's probably the only apparition of the Virgin that has been photographed widely. There was a man who was sitting, or was in his shop. He was a car repairman. And he was sitting in his shop across the street. This young Coptic man told me this story. And he saw a woman walking at the base of the dome of St. Mary's Church across the street. And he thought that she was going to commit suicide. And he ran out into the street and he yelled, "Lady, don't jump." He had a withered hand arm from birth. It was like this. So he worked with one hand and he, "Lady, don't jump." And she continued walking and he ran out and again, "Lady, don't jump." Have you heard this one? Yeah. His withered arm at that moment was made whole. He was a Muslim. And Anwar Sadat, after the thousands and thousands of people that started converging on this site, had all the buildings leveled to make room for them. And the Holy Virgin visited the clergy and bishops in the church to comfort them during this time of persecution. And I heard this story and I said to the young man, wow, why don't we have miracles like this happen in the West? And he said, but you do. You're just not noticing because you're too scientific. So, let me tell you, I expect angels unawares everywhere now. There was one year we had a pastoral conference that ended in San Francisco, and I had hurt my back, and I was walking back to the airport like this with a cane, and it was an excruciating pain, and I got back, and I went to my chiropractor, and he said, "Father, I want you to see me in 2 days, and he said, and you need to take it easy. You really did an injury to your back." And I got back to the monastery ready to take it easy, and I got a call from my archbishop, or my bishop, the vicar bishop. And he says, "Father Tryphon, you have to come. This is Friday. And Thursday is the day I got back after the conference." He says, "Father Tryphon, you have to come back to San Francisco." "What? Why?" He says, "I can't tell you. You will be reimbursed for your airfare, but you have to come back to San Francisco. I will pick you up at the airport tomorrow morning, Saturday morning." What is this about? I've injured myself. I'm not supposed to travel. If you don't, there will be serious consequences. Don't you love that? Serious consequences. What in the heck does that mean? I mean, am I going to get a spanking? And I said, so I was thinking in my mind, what could cause them to make me come now, tomorrow? And I thought, oh dear, I wonder if I've been suspended. And I suspected that Archbishop Anthony was in his presence and that he was told he couldn't tell me. So in a quiet way, I said, Ladika, have I been suspended? Yes. Great, I've been suspended. What have I done? I don't remember breaking the fast on the airline. So, Father Paul, we got an airline ticket. I got to the airport early, took the first flight I could. I got to San Francisco. The bishop was meeting me at the curbside. Give me your cross. That serious? We in the church abroad don't take. We don't monkey around with stuff. Took my cross off, handed it to the bishop. You are not to give anyone a blessing that asks for it. Great. Everybody at the cathedral knows I'm a priest. They're going to ask a blessing. What am I supposed to say? You are under suspension. So I show up at the cathedral. I still have no idea what's happened. Well, it turns out there's a woman in Seattle that used to be at St. Nicholas Greek Orthodox Cathedral, whose dad founded the cathedral, and whose brother would not be ordained a priest because he was divorced, and she was mad that I had been ordained a priest, even though I had nothing to do with the cathedral. So, she accused me of being a womanizer. Well, that's pretty serious, and if you're being accused of being a womanizer, you at least under canon law have a right to have your accuser. You know who the accuser is. Who's the accuser? Can't tell you. Tuesday morning, or Tuesday afternoon, this was Saturday, Tuesday afternoon, I'm finally vindicated, and then I found out what happened. Old Father Constantine, who was in his 80s, had been accused of being a womanizer by this same person. Because she didn't like him because he was the priest and her brother wasn't. And the archbishop had finally had it and said, we're going to let this one go, because he had written to our metropolitan. And the archbishop moved quickly to suspend me so that I wouldn't be called to New York and have this prolonged. And the archbishop said, we're going to confront this woman and she's going to receive what Father Tryphon's what he would have received. In other words, excommunication and deposition. I would have been deposed and excommunicated. So, once this went through the process, and I was able to prove that I wasn't even in the state of Washington when I was allegedly having this affair with this woman, and that the woman that I allegedly had an affair with had not been named by this person. It was just a woman. But let me tell you about the angel unaware that came to my aid, that comforted me. I was on my way. I stayed with the Capuchin Franciscan's house in San Francisco, where the superior there is one of my good friends. I figured, like, if everybody knows that I'm suspended and I'm really humiliated by this, and I don't know what's going to happen. I don't even know whether I'm going to have priesthood after this. I wanted to at least stay with some old friends. So every day I would walk the 20-minute walk on side streets to the cathedral for the morning liturgy. I'd hide in the altar. In fact, I wasn't even in the altar. I wasn't even permitted to go into the altar. So I hid somewhere, balcony, I think, one day. And then I would go to the vigil service that night. And during the rest of the day, I'm basically just kind of on my own. And the first day I'm walking, and it's raining, and I see a bag lady lying on her back or on her side with her back to me on a bench. Right next to her is one of those kiosks where you can actually be out of the rain waiting for a bus. But she's not there. She's here. And it's raining. My immediate thought was, she's dead. Otherwise, why is she here? And I looked around and people were ignoring her, and I thought, oh my gosh, this poor woman is dead. So I thought, well, I've got to do something. So I walked over, and she couldn't see me because I couldn't see her face. And all of a sudden, as I'm approaching her, she sat up. I still haven't seen her face. She put her hands up in the air, and she says, praise Jesus, praise Jesus, my friend is here. Praise Jesus, my friend is here. Praise Jesus, my friend is here. And she turned around. It was a heavy-set black lady with layers of clothing and bags. And she looked at me and she smiled. And what hit me immediately was that I had been saying the Jesus prayer. She didn't say, praise the Lord. She said, praise Jesus. And when she looked at me with such love that my heart melted and I felt like I do have a friend. And so I said to her, I'm going through a very difficult time. Would you please pray for me? Praise Jesus, help my friend. Praise Jesus, help my friend. 3 times. Little vodka. That's an inside joke. Anyway, every morning and every evening she was there. And every day, when I would step up on the curb, and I couldn't see her face, and she would do the same thing. Praise Jesus, my friend is here. Every day, coming and going. And by then, I knew she had to be an angel unaware. And I thought, God loves me. Look at the angel unaware he gave me. I mean, when was the last time you ever heard of somebody having an angel unaware ministry to them that is a black bag lady in San Francisco sitting on a park bench? I mean, I don't know anybody. And I just felt so nourished and so supported that I started I was kind of bounding in my walk. I was happy. I didn't care whether my priesthood was taken away. I had this friend in Jesus. And the last day, Tuesday, I had been down. The bishop said, we'll know today, where will you be? And I said, well, I'm going to be in the St. John Academy with the kids. I want to be with the kids. So I'm down in the St. John Academy. And the bishop walks in, Father Tryphon. Very serious, Father Tryphon. Oh, God, here we go. Come with me. So we went up into the cathedral, into the altar where my cross was lying. He took the cross, he put it around my neck, and he said, you have been restored. And I have been instructed by the Archbishop that the next time I'm in Seattle that I'm to go to this woman's house and tell her that Father Tryphon the suspension has been lifted from Father Tryphon, and you are now barred from communion for 6 months. And you need to repent. So I'm on my way back. And just before I left, I went into the bookstore, Holy Virgin Bookstore, and Father Ambrose, who's this monk from England, is behind the counter. He's a friend of mine. He's a Hirediacon. And he says, "Father Tryphon, I have these cookies. You can have this bag of cookies. They're Lenten cookies. I don't want any cookies. Father, you have to have these cookies. I don't need any cookies. You need cookies." So he gave me this unopened bag of vegan cookies. So I'm walking along with the vegan cookies. And I walk across the street praying that she's going to be there. And she was. But this time she's sitting up. She's eating Chinese food. And I thought, wow, where did she get this? And I looked right across the street from the bench is the only Chinese vegan restaurant in San Francisco that I'm aware of. It's a place that we used to go as clergy whenever we were in the city, and it was a Lenten period. So she is in during Great Lent. My angel, unaware, is eating Lenten food from that Chinese vegan restaurant. And I went over and I sat down next to her. And I said, "I have some cookies for you. They're vegan. They're Lenten." And she took them and she set them down and she put her hands up. "Praise Jesus, praise Jesus, I got dessert." 3 times. And then she hugged me. Have you ever been hugged by an angel? I was. This must be the break. Is this time for vegan cookies?
Yes.
3 to 4 more what? Minutes. Oh, minutes. 3 to 4 more minutes? Okay. Okay, so. I guess what I would say to you, dear people, that if you're not going to run into an angel unaware, at least be one. I have a practice which I've been doing for about a year now, and I got the idea when I was thinking about Bishop Mark in San Francisco, and he was quick to give the $20 bill. I now keep $20, a $20 bill, a $10 bill, a $5 bill, and a $1 bill in this pocket. If I have someone come up to me spare changing, or if I see someone that I think is in need, I reach into the pocket and I take out whatever comes out and I leave it up to God to choose, not me. And because I'm not going to judge. I don't know what they need. God knows. And there was one day I had been the speaker in downtown Seattle on the memorial for the Holocaust of the Armenians. And on my way back, it was a day that I had been having some real problems with my arthritis, and I was walking with my cane, and a bunch of young Armenians insisted on walking the block and a half to my car with me. I don't know who people thought I was because I'm with a bunch of young Armenians and they're carrying Armenian flags, big ones. And I felt like a potentate or something. And we get to my car and I take my klobuk off and my rasa off and put it in the car. And they're all standing around waiting to get a blessing. And there's a homeless guy who looked like he was probably 65, white beard, white hair. And I think he saw all these young people crowding around me thinking I must be giving out money. So he says, he kind of moved in there and he says, do you got any spare change for me? And I reached into my pocket to pull out what the Lord had for him, and it was a $20 bill. So I said, yes, and I gave him the $20 bill. And he looked at the $20. Are you sure? Are you sure? Are you sure? What was he doing in that moment? He was giving me a chance to say, oh, I'm sorry, that was not what I meant. Take it back and give him a one. And I said, well, of course I'm sure. I want you to get something good to eat. Now I can. That's the moment when God is giving him that gift. God knew he needed the 20, not a 1. God knew he was worthy of the 20, not a 1. And all I did is just be the agent. I'm sort of like the broken down taxi cab that delivers the message that God loves him. That's what we are meant to be. To be the bearer of God's love in a broken world. The bearer of God's love in a broken world. Is that it?
For now, Father, yes.
For now. Run it.